This week on AwesomeCast, we talk about hyphens, Hello Kitty duct tape, and laptops that can take out a predator, and so much more tech content too.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you.
Hey guys, it's the AwesomeCast episode 278. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter. It's AwesomeCast.net, where we talk tech from a Pittsburgh state of mind. Myself, a video producer, social media kind of guy over here, doing this kind of thing and so much more. And with a lot of people using this kind of stuff in various ways with us, as usual, from Studio B, or Studio Chilla, as I like to call it, it's John Chichilla at Chilla on the Twitter. He's our gadget guru. For a big Goliath multinational, what you might call it, company that we won't mention on the show.
I like monthly national. I like the Studio Chilla.
Studio Chilla. I keep wanting
to rock that from now on.
I know I've mentioned before, but I keep pausing not to call it Goliath National Bank, like in How I Met Your Mother, like every week. But I'm just going to go with that, I think, from now on. But
hey, I think that works.
But and also with us from Studio Dudders is Kate. Is that Kate Dudders? Sure, why not tonight? Social media peeps up there at the scare house. We'll just go scare house for that. I mean, I'm trying to narrow down what we need to, you know, I need the pitch for each one of you, right?
So. I know. I'm going to keep changing. I'm just going to keep adding new jobs. So you have to change it.
I know. I'll just pick one every week.
Okay.
She's zombie wrangler and social media extraordinaire over at Scare House. That's not what's on her business card. No. No.
No.
So. And also with us, purposely or not, it doesn't matter. He's always welcome in these doors in the awesome cast.
Surprise!
Blogger, beer advocate, and the writer for the Post Gazette here in Pittsburgh, PA. It is Mike Pound, your Uncle Crappy.
I think, can we call this the Crappy Desk? Is that
the Crappy Desk? Oh, I like that.
I think the Crappy Desk works.
That's very fitting. I like that. Okay. Okay. Straight from the Crappy Desk. I can't wait for you to get breaking news now. Resolution for 2016, soundboard. We're going to work on that one. But somebody put it in my Slack for me, please. But this is your awesome cast. Like I said, check everything out at awesomecast.net. Please subscribe to us, audio and video formats all over the place. Too many to say on a podcast. You can also follow us on social media, Twitter, Facebook, a Facebook group. And you can drop us a line and let us know your awesome things of the week on any of those formats as well. And you can join us here live at live.sorgatronmedia.com. We start kind of moseying in here digitally about 6:30 p.m. Eastern time every week. You can be part of a little bit of the pre-conversation as well and join us in the chat room like our good friends. Crazy Krause has been here since about 5:30, guys. I had to put something on this. I had to put reruns on to entertain him for the last hour. So yeah, he's tailgating. And of course, Missy's help us out with the show notes as usual. Hey, big thanks to the people that support the show. Of course, thanks to everybody sharing the shows, sharing the awesome chats, sharing some great content we have. We actually had a great talk with Leah from over at 412 Food Rescue, a great cause, trying to do something really cool here in Pittsburgh. Check that out at awesomecast.net. But also big thanks to our friends at Thistle C Business Development up there in Cranberry, PA for supporting the show. One of our executive producers on there, as well as our friend Mike Fedor at Mike Fedor Show on the Twitters. Again, both executive producers. They got the business cards to prove it. And you can too if you want to check it out and contribute at patreon.com/awesomecast. So let's get into our awesome things of the week. Let's start with Studio Chilla today.
Studio Chilla. What do I have? So I actually picked up, it's actually made by iHome and it's called the Smart Plug. A lot of sites actually refer to it by its model. So it's the ISP55. I recommend actually getting this device at Home Depot. Primarily because it's between $10 and $15 cheaper than everywhere else, including Amazon.
Nice.
So I definitely recommend picking it up there. A lot of stores don't even have it on the shelf, so ask for it. They have it in a box in the back. They'll bring it out to you at a $30 price point. This lets you actually add HomeKit type plugs to your house. So this plugs into the wall, and then you can plug something into it. So you can do things like, hey, Siri, turn off the podcast lights. Hey, Siri. Now it's not working. Hey, Siri, turn off the podcast lights. Boom. The lights are off. Turn on the podcast lights. And they're back on. So this works actually from anywhere. So you can actually set this up.
Your video paused every time you tried to do it. I think it was too much for your video to handle, and it cut out. You're still paused.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like it's too much change in the footage. and you got stuck somehow. Like it's your hangout. It's not even like the in studio here. You're frozen. Like it took a sec. Like you're still in dark mode over here.
But I can see myself okay in my frame.
That's interesting. You know what? It's the computer you're on. It's a computer on my end you're on, apparently, because I see you moving on every other one. But we get the idea. you're still in dark mode. We'll figure that out here in a moment. But
at $29.99, I thought this was an interesting buy, especially because it's one of the only HomeKit devices that doesn't need an additional hub. Mm-hmm. So if you're familiar with the Casetta, Lutron wireless devices, or Philips Hue, or any of those devices, you actually have to have an additional hub. This device actually has that all embedded and wrapped up. Works inside and outside the house. You can actually limit it that if you wanted to just make it where it worked inside your house, you could do that. I'll probably be picking up a couple of these as stocking stuffers. They're definitely good for things like Christmas trees, any kind of lamp in your house. And then you can also set up when you walk through the first time setup, it works on Android, but it also works on iOS. I'm primarily using it on iOS with the Siri based stuff. It also allows you to set up zones and themes. So if I want to say it's movie time, it'll turn off a bunch of lights or specific lights versus turning on other lights. Obviously, it's not like the Hue lights where it's going to let you set color or anything like that. It's the functionality is to turn things on or off. The other thing that I like about the Casetta, while it's a lot more expensive in like the $200 to $250 range, the Casetta and the Hue systems, bless you.
Thank you. Sorry.
The Casetta and the Hue systems allow you to actually have kind of a physical remote. So if you have people that don't have cell phones or Android tablets or whatever laying around the house, the other devices have kind of a very wall switch, wall plate look controller to them, mm-hmm. whereas this only works via your phone. But like I said, I think I'll be buying this as a couple stocking stuffers for the holidays.
Nice.
Very cool.
Check it out. Yeah, I love that. This is for – I need to get more information for you. I actually had a good conversation at Alpha Lab at the Open Coffee Club. They're actually trying to do – there's a company over there at Alpha Lab Gear trying to do home automation but without the internet. And
like in a closed system?
I think so. I don't have any more information for you, but I think we'll investigate for a later discussion. But that was kind of an interesting like, okay, that's anti what everybody else is doing, you know.
Because one of the other products that I use, the X10 equipment, is meant for closed network connectivity. It's not actually meant for coming in across the internet.
Right. But awesome. So go check that Home Depot, and it is called the – I just closed the tab. What was it called again?
It's called the iHome Plug. It's made by the same company that makes like iHome speakers and alarm clocks and whatnot.
Awesome. Go check it out. All right. Katie – I don't know about your awesome thing of the week here. Explain what happened.
Well, I got along with our house got to participate in Unstuff a Bus, which is essentially we unstuff the buses that were stuffed. I think it was 52 this year, which is awesome that the guys did such a great job. So many great gifts for kids. Well, what had happened is we unloaded at a storage facility. And I was in one of the elevators helping with the unload, and I loaded a couple boxes in and hit the button and nothing. So I was in the elevator. I'm like, hey guys, I'm stuck in the elevator. I actually hit the little phone button on the elevator, which I was like, am I supposed to hit this button? And the lady's like, oh yeah, this is the right button to hit. And I was like, okay. And they kept saying, it'll be a few more minutes, no big deal, they'll come get you. And about a half an hour into being stuck in an elevator by myself with some toys, I decided, well, Scott pushed me into periscoping it. So I periscoped from an elevator for an hour, my adventures of being stuck by myself in an elevator. And the best part was they were watching me outside the elevator. The picture I sent Sorg is a picture of me that they made me stand in a certain place in the elevator so they could take a picture of the group and I would still be in it. I'm in the elevator behind them, but I'm also appearing in Scott's phone. So if you, which I
sorry,
honestly,
sorry, I'm having trouble with the image here, but here it is.
Oh, sorry. It's so funny, but it made such a difference that I had people to talk to on Periscope while I was stuck in an elevator, because I think I would have been a lot more nervous. Mm-hmm. And I would have thought more about having to use the restroom, because I was like, I'm stuck in an elevator. I haven't peed in a while. What's going to happen? And it was fun because it was like the interactions I was getting. I had 300 and some. At one point, I had 70 people watching me at one time. And by the end of it, it was like 300 and some plus that had watched my adventure in the elevator. And they were all being very nice. And at one point, at the beginning of the conversation, I said, don't say the P word. And someone else would bring it up in the chat. And someone else would tell them, oh, don't say the P word. I was like, see, they know. They caught on. And I think the best part about this is I had set out the photo that I was stuck in an elevator and to my boyfriend and my mom. And he did not believe that I was stuck in the elevator until he saw the video posted on Facebook, the Periscope video. He's like, oh, you weren't kidding. I thought you were kidding. I sent him the picture and he said, oh, I could think of worse ways to die. No, I'm legit stuck in an elevator. You don't understand. So yes, Periscope is a great place to hang out when you are stuck in an elevator.
That's great. I actually caught up with Sean at RWA Saturday night about that.
Oh, yeah. Too.
So I got the outside the elevator version of the story.
Amazing.
So yeah, it was good. It was good. And I was the same way, because I saw it pop up. I'm like, oh, she's just stuck with a pack of toys in there. And for whatever reason, like the Periscope wouldn't load it when I was at the coffee shop, because I was doing like too many things to begin with. And I had the same reaction. I'm like, oh, whatever. Then it's like, not until like 2 hours later, I'm like, oh god, she was actually stuck. I'm glad to say I wasn't the only one, but yeah.
Nope, nobody believed me. I was really stuck by myself in an elevator, picking one of the boxes as my pee box in case it came down to that.
Yeah. Well, you know what? You're the kind of person that periscopes like so many different things. I'm like, oh, how quaint. She's in an elevator, a periscope. But like, oh, wait, she's still on the elevator. Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Wait.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yep. So anything happens on my periscope.
There you go.
Was there a particular toy that you would have peed on? Did you actually make that selection?
Yeah, well, the nice thing is the boxes for stuff a bus, the ones they had places where you could drop off the toys, were about waist high. So I figured if I emptied them out, I could just duck in there. Nobody on the camera in the elevator would see me. Right. But I was with the toys. I was very upset. So many required batteries that I wanted to play with. And there was a set of colored pencils, but none of them were sharpened. It was like my own special hell.
It's like a nightmare. It's like a Christmas nightmare. Wow. So there you go. Technology helping you cope, apparently.
Yes.
In this case. So there you go. Uncle Crappy, what do you have for us this week?
Nothing nearly that interesting, unfortunately. I can't claim to being stuck in a, I was not aware. I missed that whole thing. And actually I came home from work that day and Mrs. Crappy's like, did you see what happened to Dudders? And so she had to go back and explain because she got to see all this. My awesome thing, the timing for this is actually works out pretty well, because we just launched at my employer, which is the green newspaper in town, launched a new page for our photo galleries. It's a product of a lot of work. I'm especially happy with how it looks on mobile, because this is a thing that I tinker with a lot professionally now. But it's called a Pittsburgh in Focus. You can find it at post-gazette.com/photos. It's something that we're going to, the photographers and the other visual people, I guess that includes me to a certain extent, we'll spend a fair amount of time tinkering with to give you guys a different look at some of the work that they do, wow. Some of the work that I do as well. So please go check that out. I'd love to hear what you think. And we have a big thing about Pascal mm-hmm. Dupuis retiring all of a sudden today. That was today's big deal. So not as exciting as getting stuck in an elevator.
Sorry.
It's okay.
So I got to say, so I'm taking a peek through this. This is the first time I'm looking at it. And I know a lot of the discussion, I don't know if you have to be part of this too, but, you know, with the apocalypse and what, like, especially newspapers are being called out for how dire they look, I guess. for instance, not do any slams on anybody particularly local or anything in particular. But this is a very nice, clean the HTML5-y. I got to be honest. I do have my ad blocker on, so I don't know if there are a lot of any kind of pop-ups that might be on here. So I'll actually disable it to be an honest viewer here. But no, it looks very nice and probably, you know, and even the ads aren't all that bad when they do pop up, which is nice. And I imagine this looks like it's a responsive sort of design. It's going to look. What's that?
That is a nice part of the page, and that was one of the goals, to make this fairly clean. We've engaged a lot of time discussing about load times. So that was something that we wanted to take care of this as well, yeah. Especially, you know, a photo heavy pages. That can be a real concern, but pleased with how this one turned out. So y'all go check it out.
That's good. I mean, and that's a big thing. I mean, in a day when newspapers need to, you know, catch up digitally and get some attention these days, you're competing with the bigger guys that are doing clean designs. You know, I just saw Engadget just redesigned. And again, I keep forgetting I have an ad blocker on. And I'm just like, there's so much white space over here. What's going on?
What are they doing?
What are they doing with all this white space? It doesn't make any sense. This is a horrible design. Then I realize, oh, that's where the ads go. Oh, okay. And for me, it's like, you know, it's security and such, like, you know, and we've all had that. I was getting annoyed. Uproxx is kind of off my Christmas card list as far as mobile goes, because mm-hmm. it pops up that thing after you've been watching, you know, reading for a moment, and I end up going somewhere else. And there are especially smaller market newspapers that are just horrendous with those kinds of ads. And I don't think Post Gazette or others in town have been plagued by that in particular, if I recall. Like, they weren't pretty, but they weren't that bad.
Especially the mobile stuff has been an emphasis for my employer recently, and that's right. One of the things that I'm supposed to be to working on every day. So I'm happy that they took the time with this site to make that work. Generally, that is something we emphasize when we do a larger package. We want to make sure that it looks good in that format too. So it's good stuff.
What was the site? I didn't get the URL.
post-gazette.com/photos.
Post-gazette without the hyphen also works as well. Because I've been doing that by default, honestly, and it goes right through.
Yes. Unbelievable.
What? I'm sorry, I'm messing with your brand, man. That hyphen, I tell you what. The hyphen is everything, right?
Yep.
That's in the manual. Awesome. Go check out. Yeah, no, this looks really good. I'm gonna have to I imagine a lot of this goes over to the Instagram as well. It's linked up here.
Yes.
Okay. Cool. Nice to see that popping up. So definitely gonna follow that stuff around. All right. I was trying to remember who's next, and I realized that's me.
Did you get stuck in any elevators?
I did not get stuck in an elevator. I got stuck at a wrestling show this weekend. I don't want to get too far into it, because I actually did about 17 minutes on this concept for basic Sorgonomics today. So go over to Sorgatron.com. So if you watch my wrestling products, you know that we haven't been HD yet. Okay. And partly because I had this old, if I can find the button. I got this old thing, this old switcher, a nice thing that I think a lot of churches use. It's SD, and you see, I kind of had another camera that I was using as an intake to turn it into FireWire so I can capture it digitally so I have a backup, right? This is what we've been doing since about 2012 when I took over this part of the biz. Is somebody got a cricket going? What's happening here?
Oh, dang it. Sorry, the cat. I'm at home. I'm like, Jeff got the cat pedestal and I forgot the cricket.
Are you telling me I'm boring over here? What's happening?
Sorry.
So I let Katie have the soundboard again. but I updated it with a few of these things. These are the Blackmagic Shuttle. And you see it's got all the outputs. That's why I kind of picked these guys. This is the USB 3 edition, but I also have a Thunderbolt edition as well. Have those going in the computer. And using Wirecast, just like what I have here, which I think I put in another tab. No, there it is. And there it is. That's it. Got another soundboard. So since it replaced a lot of what the hardware was doing, but I usually was, that's somebody else's contact. We're just going to, as a business card. Okay. We kind of were able to replace a lot of that big hardware with this. And now I have like all this table space and I don't know what to do. Mostly went okay. Couple technical glitches, that we need to work out and smooth over. But I think for a maiden voyage, we did very well. We are HD 720. I didn't push the envelope too far on the first run out, and I think it's pretty good. So these things, if you're looking for these are also recommended for if you're doing Let's Plays with like Xboxes and PlayStations as well. Like there's a lot of tutorials on that. I will caution you, these are very, when you use Blackmagic hardware, they're very stringent and picky. Like you have to know what the resolution and frame rate is that whatever you're using is outputting to it. You know, HD, 720, 1080i versus P, 30 frames per second, 60 frames per second, and you have to set that accordingly. It's a lot easier than it was a year ago when I was experimenting with this stuff. This thing I've had for over a year, almost 2 years maybe, and I just haven't had much success for my needs until now, where everything kind of lined up, right? Blackmagic and Wirecast, and also cool to use Wirecast in a different environment than podcasting. We've used it actually before in some live streaming, mostly just to get us to YouTube Live. But it's kind of nice to, you know, take it out of the studio here and use it in a bigger format. So Wirecast, again, these are a little more. It's about a $400-$500 program. More details over at Sorgatron.com. And check out the video on basic Sorgonomics about that. And I'm sure I'll have some more to talk about as we go and we experiment. We start growing with the setup and perfecting it for everything. So that's what I got. All right. So with that, and your Slice on Broadway ad of the week, because Chilla's got the Slice this week.
I do have the Slice this week. If you look here, I apologize. I got hungry during the show, so I started eating the Slaughterhouse Five. So we have the Slaughterhouse Five, which is your pepperoni, your bacon, your sausage, your capricole, and your prosciutto. Definitely a great pie, followed up by my other favorite, the chicken pesto pie, which is a basil pesto sauce with small spinach or baby spinach, chicken, and roasted red tomatoes. So definitely a tasty, tasty meal. I highly recommend that. I think Sorg, one of your favorites, is the Gonzo. Mm-hmm. And keep in mind that they can take any pizza and make it a sub, and any sub and make it a pizza.
That's right. We had some here. We were doing a Sawtooth Willie filming here on Friday night. Got some pizza. We had an audience for Sawtooth Willie. The audience for filming Sawtooth Willie is growing. Like, I have more people in studio when we're filming that than we do for any of the podcasts at this point. cricket.
Wait, this is what you're dealing with. This is all it is.
I know what that is.
Oh,
I just threw it away.
But anyways, so Slice Hot Broadway's been supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza for well over a year and a half here. Thank you so much for helping them feeding the in-studio guests here. Check them out, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_slice on the Twitters, and look them up on Facebook and Instagram, and let them know you heard about them on AwesomeCast. Thanks a lot. Sawtooth Willie approved, by the way. So thanks to them. All right.
How does he chew pizza? How does that work?
It is a gumming action. I mean, he's only missing one tooth. I mean, he has the rest of it.
Okay.
And he does. And he does something very interesting with that gap this next set of episodes, by the way. So keep an eye out for that, and Merry Christmas. Yes. So we had some stuff from our audience. Katie, you and I both got this email today. I didn't get to sink too far into this, but it's yourprimer.com. You can find out about this. And I got it downloaded. I didn't get too far from that. But Doug Derda of ShouldIDrinkThat.com. I can't wait for him to hear that. He was letting us know this is a free service that Google has rolled out for 5-minute sessions to help digital advertising content measurement and strategy. He took the first lesson on creating creative beefs while doing something quick and finished. Okay, I'm not reading that part. Perfect reading because we all know you have it in there with you. It says it's a nice thing, and you can pin cards to go back and revisit. Plus, there are key takeaways from each lesson. So again, Google kind of, and I'll see if I can boot it up here to show off a little bit. Google kind of, expanding that education kind of aspect here. Katie, did you have an opportunity to take a peek at this?
No, I didn't. Sorry.
That's okay. But kind of a pretty cool kind of mini lessons kind of situation here. And I'm kind of digging on that. It is available for iOS and Android. It's Google Primer, and you can get it now for free. So I know some people that have expressed interest in kind of getting into marketing and advertising and actually forwarded this to them. This could be a nice little thing to kind of start wrapping your head around a few things. So go check it out. Yourprimer.com if you want more information on that. So thanks, Doug, at Doug Derda on Twitters. For that. He was also popped us a comment earlier in the week. Facebook just punched Meerkat and Periscope in the gut. So apparently they opened up their Facebook video streaming. We talked about this before. This was the thing that like celebrities had it, right? Like Ricky Gervais had it. Some WWE wrestlers had it. But apparently they are opening this up to the general public. Which, and it's part of, I think, it is an app separate from Facebook, but it integrates pretty nicely with it. And I know I was looking at a few things. You can actually subscribe to get notifications, pretty much like Periscope whenever somebody goes on. So, when Katie's stuck in an elevator and she wants to be on Facebook, I'll know about it.
Pay attention to me.
Exactly. But they're beginning to test it. This was back on the 3rd, so last Thursday, actually. And they're starting to kind of roll it out, I think, slowly to begin with. I think, this is going to eat the lunch of as long as, it's easy enough. I cannot imagine Periscope and Meerkat holding up to this. I mean, Meerkat's barely holding its own against Periscope backed by Twitter, right? And they're doing a celebrity thing just like apparently I'm supposed to take my shirt off whenever I'm on this, according to this video. Okay. All right. I don't know if I'm sold on this one. Apparently only attractive people are allowed on this one that work out a lot. But anyways, go live with friends. It says, I don't know it could work, but I don't know. Facebook Skype calling really take off?
No.
Mm-mm.
No.
No.
But. Does Facebook? I wonder about this because I think that the Twitter has an immediacy that Facebook maybe does not.
Mm-hmm.
And so I could be completely in the minority about this, but I think a streaming service on that works well, that integrates well with Twitter. Maybe that's a better fit than something that Facebook does. That's how I feel. I mean, I use Periscope in the course of work. I use and those are broadcast live on Twitter, and I generally upload those to Facebook after the fact.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the impact of Periscoping stuff live, whether you're stuck on an elevator or not, works best in a platform like Twitter.
Mm-hmm. Katie, you're the biggest Periscoper here, obviously. I don't know. What do you think about yet another player in that space?
I think, one with Periscope, even when I try to pull up my video from the elevator, it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
So that's so I think the availability of maybe if Facebook is able to store these videos long term without you having to upload it afterwards might be an advantage. But like Crappy says, it's Twitter is my immediate. Facebook is me catching up with what people did overnight or in the morning or, you know, when I get a few minutes. But I'm not constantly on Facebook like I'm constantly on Twitter.
Right.
So I would not get the, I mean, the notifications would be nice, but we already get so many notifications for things.
That's what needed an ping, right?
Yeah, I know. I just, I Facebook usually pulls something out that I go, oh, wait a minute, that's awesome. So I'm waiting for that, that I just, that must thing.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see how this shakes out. Yet another feature. And I don't think it's as distinguishable as when they put out like a they're calling it, what are they calling it? Facebook Live, right? Yeah, introducing live video collage. They don't have a name for it really at this point. So I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how it grows. So thanks, Doug, for passing that along as well. We had another one. I'm going to bump this up here in the lineup. So Lightroom, Lightroom's kind of the big photo editing app. That you guys can pick up part of the I own a copy of Lightroom, but I've never used it because I paid the $10 for the photography bundle on Adobe's Creative Cloud. So you get Photoshop and Lightroom in there. There's now a mobile version of it for iOS and Android. You can go check that out. And so I hit up some of our friends that I knew were big photography buffs. And Chilla, I know you're kind of in this. Now, you haven't used Lightroom a lot, right?
I have not used Lightroom a lot. Only because I didn't need something on my mobile device, and it wasn't free on my desktop. So that's the reason I haven't chosen really any kind of organizational thing. Mm-hmm. And then the thing that really sealed the deal was Google Photos being free. Right. But anyway, go with your...
Right, and it's a kind of a trimmed-down version. So I reached out to Daniel Hooven on the Twitter and Rob De La Creta, the original co-host over here on AwesomeCast, and I know they're like big in the photos, both professionally and hobby, etc. Great stuff with the Inns team, Rob. But anyway, great photo that popped up the other day, actually. As the professionals, you know, saying it's useless for editing, you're not going to have the full suite of functionality on those platforms, but it's good for showing off and organizing a little bit. No color collaboration or profiles, you know, it's not going to be that big of a thing. And that's the thing is we're seeing a lot of kind of stripped down stuff. There was an article last week talking about how Premiere's clip application is on mobile, now on Android. It's been on iOS for a little bit. I mean, they're taking little bits of Adobe Suite and kind of dropping it onto mobile platforms, which is nice to kind of start a job and then you upload it into the cloud. It's persistent, and then move it to something else.
I think that's the whole point of a lot of these mobile tools is they take the big tool and they snip it or they clip it down in or create a bunch of sub tools that allow you to kind of use your workflow in the way that makes sense to you. And then to your point, kind of push it up into a cloud and then you can kind of finish with the full suite on a desktop. Mm-hmm. I just think we're still a little further than a lot of companies would like to be from that full on suite on a mobile device, especially when you get into a 5-inch screen. You just don't have the real estate that you do on a 20-inch, 25-inch, whatever 4K monitor to start really getting down and dirty with your video editing. I mean, Sorg, you know how it is with video. It's not that far off from photos. Where would you want to do all of your work on a small screen?
No, I couldn't imagine doing it. I was actually as a point. I after my lunch meeting today, I just brought my iPad with me, and with the with the new Zag keyboard, I was like, well, I'm getting a lot done on this thing whenever I pull it up, and I just did emails and connections, just kind of touching base with a lot of people, writing up some stuff for a good hour at the coffee shop before coming home, and but also I was realizing how limited it is. Like we're still at that point, like setting up the document in Google Docs, I couldn't figure out in the app how to duplicate a file so I could bring the show notes over and start working on them. I had to actually log in remotely to the studio computer here and do it in a browser, right? So we're still limited at those points. But I think when you go to the iPad Pro and that size, I think you get closer to the point where, well, we can do a little bit more. You know,
right.
You know, I think for illustrators, I think it's a big boon for them. You know, I think there is a point where for certain professionals or hobbyists, they can start on an iPad and do most of the thing they need to on an iPad. And then, flip it off to the next person that needs to take that to the next level, you know.
I think what the advantages for something like this are for people who are in business who don't want to go to that level. Like, for example, like if I want to post, if I'm taking something or a photo of myself that I'm advertising some bit of clothing, like I just want to clean it up in a way that maybe Instagram can't do it or the photo editing software that comes with your phone can't do it. There's so many nice tweaks in Lightroom that you can do that kind of quickly without even knowing very much about Lightroom. You know what I mean? Without knowing how photo editing works. And get them kind of wham bam quickly out there. So things where you might be wanting to post things up business wise that you just want those extra settings that you want out there, as opposed to somebody not passing it on to the next level. But that's all the highest, you know, it's an additional. That's the highest level it'll go.
They also can be a really good introductory to Lightroom, right? Oh, Lightroom's that important thing that all my photo friends that I don't understand at that level what that's about, right? And oh, great, you tried it out. Oh, you really need to pay for Creative Cloud now, right? Mm-hmm. And now, now I'm paying for Creative Cloud, whether I use the full-on Lightroom or not at this point.
Yeah.
And also, like I said, it's a more advanced thing to make your Instagrams look good.
Yeah.
So, like, the next
level. I could put that on my resume. I've used Lightroom.
Mobile.
There you go.
Lightroom, done.
Mobile.
Yeah, there you go.
Exactly.
I'm a photographer.
Stuff like this is helpful for word people in the journalism world who are suddenly being asked to take photographs or if we expand this a little bit to prepare short video clips. I don't include myself with this because I tinker with visual stuff a lot, but those folks, you know, they want something kind of quick and kind of easy. You can do some of that stuff with the native software that we're talking about, iOS or Android. But if you need to do a little bit more, it's helpful. It's helpful. I understand, you know, why someone who shoots at the level that Rob does would be dismissive. I probably would be too. But in that context, this is not a bad thing.
Exactly. Even when you're looking at the mobile site over here, they're like, create a collection, add your photos, capture a photo, edit the photo, share the photo, and then you install Lightroom CC on your computer so you can refine your photos. It's an introductory thing, like I said, or it's a little bit of, you know, well, why the heck would I want Office on my iPhone? Because you're familiar with it. If you're very ingrained in Adobe and you can bring at least a little piece of that application you're familiar with, be it Premiere, Photoshop, Lightroom, I think that helps that as well. And gets you, again, keeps you in that ecosystem and you continue. I think give Microsoft Adobe money like that. I think it's real good for that. And I think, you talked about kind of the different levels of people, and there are, I guess I kind of do things a hard way because I didn't have all these easy fun tools several years ago when I started this thing, right? But so many are getting so much done with these in creative ways and working around those limitations, like we're seeing with Vine, Snapchats, Instagrams, right? How many movies you see that shot on an iPhone, but they had a little bit extra hardware, you know, but it, a lot of capabilities. And I think it just lowers that barrier. It's really awesome. So speaking of creative endeavors, we're doing a lot of fun stuff over here. Sidekick Media Services. We're doing a lot of marketing videos here with a lot of people. I'm talking with some really cool people and some fun new projects going to be coming up here in the coming months. But if you want to see what's going on, go over to sidekickmediaservices.com. We can help you with your podcast, with your marketing video, and social media help as well. We can throw together a website for you, whatever you need there in the digital realm. And we have a lot of samples over there. You can check out the demo reel, what we've been doing here at Sorgatron Media over the years, and we're trying to make those available to anybody that needs them. So please hit that up. Follow us on social media. Hit up the contact page if you have any questions on something we can help you with. And see if you can name all the Steelers in our video.
No, I can't.
No, you can't.
No. I couldn't name any of the Cleveland Browns if they showed up in your video either. So
you're an outsider. You're an outsider. Listen.
I'm starting a quarterback for the Browns this weekend, by the way.
I think we got like the best mix for a demo video. We have Pittsburgh Steelers. We have the now mayor when he was running for it. We have zombies.
You got everybody covered. That's
perfect. We have TV personalities. We got everything in there. We've got Chachi floating over the point in a parachute, parasailing out there. I mean, we got everything. We've been everywhere over the last how many years we've been doing it. I even make a cameo in this as a protester. So go check that out. Yeah, we've been doing things for a bit. SidekickMediaServices.com. And we do a lot of podcasts. You can check out this quick clip of last week in Sorgatron Media.
Have you interacted with the train in such a way where you had to run alongside it for any reason?
Had to? No, did, yes.
Ah!
Do you have to have the little A thing for them to deliver on?
Yeah, do I have to put like a little like Amazon square? Yeah, you do. She picks it up. Yeah, it lands right on the little A. I guess it looks for it. Mm-hmm. And then you pick it up and you take your A inside. So I got to run out back.
This is the Amazon landing zone.
Yeah, exactly.
Years ago, I got to be a part of Team Taz, and one of the things he really liked about me was my promos and creativity, and that I had a brand and I made sure everything stayed on brand. And I was trying to think of a way that I could do promos and make them a little bit more interesting.
And then we found out the reason we haven't seen front of the show Logan Shulo for the last almost 2 years is he's been freaking doing an album with Jim Johnston because the Drifter got a music video debuted this week, man. Check it out, man. It sounds good. We are back, the AwesomeCast. Check out all that stuff at Sorgatron.com. And we got a couple fun segments right here. First of all, what is Crappy drinking? Because he's always, you know, he is the beer guy of the Post Gazette. And
I do a beer show with PG. If you do post-gazette.com/beerme, you'll find this video series. This has nothing to do with that. It's just a delicious bottle I found in my fridge that I thought would work for tonight. Oatmeal Stout by Great Divide. Oatmeal Yeti. Yeti's the kind of their stout brand. This is brewed with raisins, which is an interesting kind of very subtle sweet twist with a stout that is typically a kind of a beefier thing to drink. It's high test, which means I'm going to be kind of silly by the time I finish this bottle. It's about a 9.5 ABV. So I'll try to control myself, but it's very well done. It's very nice beer.
There you go. Oh, I have your audio won't go away. I can't de-audio your video here. There's a little bit of him in action over there on Beer Me over at the Pittsburgh Gazette. So go check that out. All right. And another new segment on the show. Oh, wait. I almost forgot one. Hold on. You're still telling me about beer. There we go.
Shut the guy up.
All right. Jeez. So I almost forgot about this. Thanks to Chachi for this donation. But in this week's edition of this Ye Olde Tech. So this is a, hey, look how large that box is, first of all. I hope you're on video here. Yeah, look at this thing. It's bigger than my head. and it's got a face on it too, so it's rather they'll just do the show like this. This is a copy of, you know, back in the day when we used to have a store called Babbage's. There used to be software in boxes. Yeah. And you may think, wow, how big were the floppy disks back then? No, this is a CD-ROM in this thing, and it sounds like not much else, okay? I don't know, because this is a sealed copy of a game called Virtual Vegas. And let's see, do I have a copyright year on this? 1994. By the way, I'm going to enter this to win a free trip to Las Vegas. Always runs QuickTime and is a CD-ROM for Macintosh and Windows. So I'm sure there's a lot of includes voice recognition technology for Windows. Sorry, Mac. And this is running you need a hot screaming 25 megahertz 386 chip computer or a Macintosh, and there's just a bunch of numbers there I don't understand. So thank you, Chachi, for that. So that's gonna hang out back here, and I can't even think we could run it on anything that's in the studio.
That's spectacular. I moved to Pittsburgh in 1994, actually.
Yes, and he was playing this back then. So there's hardly a screenshot on here. Oh, there's this wonderful lady here. Oh, they left on crappy. There's this wonderful lady here, and she's digitalized in 16-bit glory right there. So there you go. The road, take a road trip on the information highway.
Well,
that's excellent.
An oasis of adventure awaits, but this is no desert. Richly, this is like a fanfic. Richly landscaped virtual worlds of interactive excitement provide you with the vacation you've always dreamed of. I don't know if I dreamed of this thing. This looks crazy. All right, that's gonna go back there and have fun with that. It's no solitaire, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, and the new segment for this week, we're going to go shopping with Katie. Katie, now you're, I can't believe the day has come. The day has finally come. So I hope you're on video because this is wonderful white plastic MacBook that she's always trucking to our meetings with Hello Kitty tape? No.
Yeah, duct tape.
Duct tape. There's a crack. That's a big crack right there. And finally, when was this purchased?
2007.
I actually have one of those sitting on my desk at work.
Aw, yeah. This is
in
it.
A frame? Like,
no, it still runs. It's really loud.
No,
the fan's going bad, but it does work.
That's outstanding.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Again, remind me. What is the reason there is Hello Kitty duct tape on here? It's not a beautification project, right?
Nope, surprisingly not. Okay, I don't know if you're looking at home. If you look at the old MacBooks, the plastic around the keyboard, mm-hmm. there's this little teeny sliver that they had here. It's this little itty bitty thing there. Mm-hmm. Well, this eventually peels off. If you can see there, none, some. And if you rest your hands on here where there's none, it hurts really, really bad.
And it starts to crack because on the top of the monitor, on around the bezel of the screen, there's two little plastic lips that push down into.
Yep.
There they are.
Oh.
It was a design defect.
Oh no. You've been.
So you think I can call them?
They would originally replace that.
Oh dang it! Do you think they'll still do?
No, I think you're off the Apple Core. Apple Care.
Can we record you calling Apple Care about your issues with your laptop?
Oh, you should totally give that a try.
I mean, completely. So it, has it given up the ghost?
No, it's fine. It's still good. I've been informed that apparently the Hello Kitty duct tape is not for professional use. And that's the main selling point of why I need to replace it.
Wait. Well, like
besides the fact that I could worth weights with this.
So basically you're at the point that you've been told that your laptop is not up to dress code for work.
Mm-hmm. Plus apparently the lifting and carrying of this behemoth is more than I should be doing.
Wait, are you suffering physical ailments from hoisting this behemoth laptop around?
Carrying it around in my backpack along with books, yes. I'm sure I have several back ailments from this.
This is true. Actually, at some point, I was walking back to my car when the PG's offices were still on the Boulevard of the Allies, and this car pulls up on the street as we're getting close to Point Park, and Dudders like falls out of this car. And I swear to God, this happened. And I have to think it was because, I mean, she has this, you guys have seen this gigantic backpack, and it sort of led mm-hmm. with mm-hmm. that. So she's falling out of this car on top of this backpack. And I just thought, wow, that looks really heavy.
When if you fall over, are you like a turtle?
She was. I actually had to help her up.
Okay. Yeah, with the backpack, I would be a turtle.
I actually just looked it up. That's a 5-pound laptop.
That's a big deal. I don't think it's a big deal. I mean, it's nice.
By today's standards, it's definitely heavy.
Mm-hmm. I've upgraded the RAM and changed the battery, and that's the only thing I've had to do with it, so I can't complain.
You can change the battery? What?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, they pop right off. See? There's a little thing, and you just go, boop, and there you go. I'd have to probably remove some of the duct tape, though.
But anyways, you're looking for shopping advice, because you have not searched for a new laptop in 8 years. Okay.
And I mean, I'm not totally not sold on like a tablet-y way of going about things, but I don't know. Like I the Surface Pros things look cool. Another MacBook would be cool.
What do you do?
What do I do?
What do you say you do here?
Besides like to carry heavy objects around.
It makes me look cool to my friends. I'm into the social media thing, so I have to be able to go online, which is everything I know. I can save the major things. I have a Mac Mini, so I can save the heavy duty photo editing and stuff on there. So that's not a big deal. This would be primarily things I would take with me if I was, you know, if I had a presentation in a meeting, or if I needed notes on something, or if I just need to show somebody, oh, here, this is what a PowerPoint presentation.
You know, to be honest.
And then as a word processor, too, because I still do go on and type papers.
To be honest, and Chilla, I don't know if you're on the same page here, but given what you do and for my understanding of your work, Katie, I think you would be okay with like an iPad keyboard combination, to be honest. I mean, you're in the Apple ecosystem already. I don't know when's the last time you've used Windows extensively?
To be honest, I have my mom's laptop, which is, look at that, it's got touch screen.
What collection of laptops what are we on? Are we on your phone again? Okay.
I always go for my iPhone because it's the best picture.
She's just like pulling laptops. Just
talked about my tablet. I have a tablet.
The
Windows thing scares me. I'm not as good with the Windows usage here. Mm-hmm.
Or even a Chromebook, to be honest. Because for what you do, I think you get more, it'll be more money, of course, but I think you get more functionality out of an iPad because you have Lightroom, for instance, right? You know, stuff like that. At least you could do that, right? Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I'm thinking Chromebook or iPad keyboard combo, given budget. What do you think, Chilla?
I would go iPad Air 2 with a keyboard. Mm-hmm. But when you start to add in a decent keyboard, you're getting into that, well, for $100 or $200 more, it opens up, because I wouldn't go with a 16 gig tablet, right?
No.
I would at least jump up to the 64, which is the next step up. Mm-hmm. So with that, I'm going to question, I would go, if it were me, mm-hmm. I would go with the actual MacBook, the new ultralight 1.1 gigahertz dual core M processor. Because, I mean, you can actually get away with some Sorg. I know you're going to disagree with me, but I don't know if you've gone into the store and launched up Final Cut.
Not on that.
Yeah, go into the store and launch Final Cut on that. And watch how fast and amazing it is.
Oh.
Where you're going to lag out is it's going to take longer to render the video.
Mm-hmm.
But almost any of the operations that you're going to do and the $1,200, the $1,299 price point with the Retina and the Retina screen on that, I think is going to get you a lot more with your social media and running a bunch of applications simultaneously. And everyone is frozen on my screen. Am I frozen for you guys?
No, we got you.
Okay. So that's where I would come in, and I would actually, after that, if you were willing to look at Windows, I would actually look at the Surface 3, which is their Core M style Atom based ultra lightweight. You could definitely, and here's where I'm going with this, Sorg, and I don't know what it's like for you, bouncing between massive amounts of social media on the tablet. It's good if you want to focus on one thing.
Right.
And I think it actually forces you to focus on one thing and doing one thing.
And that was my
experience. Is very useful for writers, social right. media people, things of that nature. But the moment that you want to actually multitask, I think is where they're getting there, but your workflow could start to fall apart. Mm-hmm. Or you're going to be sacrificing things and you're going to be saying, oh, I'll wait till I get back home to my iMac. Or I think, Sorg, you do this, and I know I do this a lot. Oh, I'll just Chrome remote desktop back to my desktop at home for my, my iPad.
That's exactly what I did for my iPad today, just to make a copy in Google Drive. So there's limitations, unfortunately, because of some of the apps. But,
Because I'm spoiled. I spent, you know, a decent, what was it? I think it was like $1,300 on this, but I've had it for 1,000 years as I bench press.
Right. Because I mean, you're also not pushing it to its limits for with the work you do. I mean, I price point wise, I think you'd be okay with an Air. To be honest, if you're going there and you want, like, I want a laptop, I want to stay in the Mac ecosystem. I think you'd be.
I would go Air 2.
Air 2. MacBook Air.
Oh, MacBook Air.
If you wanted to stay a laptop.
The only thing that after going Retina, I can't go back.
Once you go Retina, you never go back.
Like that's why I was going instead of the Air, going the MacBook line. Because the MacBook, you get the Retina screen now. Mm-hmm. And that's where, like, coming from the Air and going to the Pro, the MacBook and the Pro have a more on-par screen with an iPad than the iPad Air does.
Mm-hmm. Do you have
a problem? Or you can wait. If you can make it to March, you might see a new device come out, or a new... just a refresh of the line.
So get some white tape and hang out till March. So,
well, you don't understand. Like, my mom's over here saying that, well, this duct tape is probably discontinued. So I probably, my mom's trolling me.
They're already joining us in the chat room. But anyways,
just one here. I'll hand her a laptop, which has touchscreen capabilities and weighs less than 1,000 pounds.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you have a target price range?
No, I don't. It's partially a Christmas present.
Oh, In that case.
Now we look at Mama Dutters.
In that case, MacBook Pro.
We're going to find a way to make a $10,000 laptop.
I don't think you can get too far off from that, to be honest.
That can be done.
I mean, have you played in the configurator on the shop on Apple lately? It's kind of a lot of fun. If that's the case, I feel like for familiarity, yeah, I think between the Air and the MacBook blank, I guess, probably be okay in there. Just stay with that familiar thing, and you know it's going to last a bit. Get your Apple Care and stuff, and you're going to be fine.
The interesting thing, and it's the one thing that I will say for carrying, I've actually started 2 days a week carrying the Surface 3 to work, and it's something I would really find myself appreciating for the MacBook, is the USB-C charge. So your power brick to carry for your device with the MacBook is the same as the power brick for the iPad. With a USB cable. So if you can find crickets, you can find a charger for your for your MacBook.
Stop it! Cricket has already interrupted the show twice.
I will say, like, because I've actually stopped taking the charger for the Surface 3 with me, because it uses a micro USB. which I have 100 of those cables sitting on my desk.
Yes.
And I can plug it pretty much into any charger that I have, which definitely comes in handy. So when you go, it's going to be funny, right? Because you're going to go from like a 1/4-pound power cord and a 5-pound laptop to a 2-pound laptop with a pretty much non-existent power brick.
Yeah, look at this.
All that cordiness and I don't know. Have you replaced that? Because I have not gone through like a year of a laptop without having to drop the $80 on a new one of those.
This
bricks.
Guy?
Yeah, the power bricks for the.
Well, no. This has been fine. I had to replace the little doodad, the flip down.
Yeah.
And because that broke, and then I just got this last year. See this nice cord? It makes it longer.
Oh wait, they didn't come with the cord back then?
Wow.
No.
No, you just got the you had to buy the extension cord separate. It's funny that you mentioned that, Sorg, because I actually for my older 2011 Air, mm-hmm. I still have the original power brick and cord with no issue. And that thing's I got in 2011.
I'm traveling a lot. Listen, I'm working at a different place every day. It's just that
necessity. Well, it went to work with me every day.
Yeah. But it's like, then I'm like, I don't have like, I'm sitting at a desk and I plug it in here and everything's cool. You know, it's like coffee shop here. Oh, we're over here. Let's go over here. Here, we're at the workspace today. We're up in the office. We're in the living room, whatever. You know, it's my buddy, you know.
And that's the nice thing about the MacBook, the MacBook blank. Mm-hmm. You're talking all day battery life on that.
Right. I'd say look at those. I would for you, I think get to an Apple store, get your hands on.
Can I take my old one with me?
Yeah, for comparison.
Oh, just you should.
I would.
Do
oh,
that.
I definitely would.
Do that.
Oh my God, can you tell me about this?
Do that and watch the Apple employees gather around you. to witness.
Because does your battery still hold a charge?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So my battery doesn't hold a charge anymore, so I have to have it plugged in all the time.
But she's replaced it, remember? So
yeah, I replaced it once, but that was about 3 years ago, 4 years ago. I can't complain.
Well, Katie, keep us updated on your adventures and new laptop as we say. What, you don't have to say goodbye to your old laptop. You can just use it for other stuff.
Just won't take it everywhere.
Yeah, it's just like that home thing that you, I don't know, like. Do whatever on, watch TV on.
It would actually be easier for me to walk around with my Mac Mini and a tiny monitor than it would be to walk around with this.
All right. Perfect. I hope we helped you out there, and I hope that discussion, that thinking has helped anybody else out there kind of looking for laptops. I know we're very Mac-centric, but she started from one. And
it's funny because we started this conversation talking about the Pixel C went on sale today.
yes we did,
which is Google's half kind of laptop,
right? So I mean, this is, I mean, is this mostly, this seems like it's the what Surface Book kind of concept a little bit, right? Like, is this the not the responses, I think they announced it first, right?
Yeah, it's kind of like the Surface Book type device. The interesting thing, because the Pixel, if you remember the original Pixel that launched at one of their major developer conference. The original Pixel ran Chrome OS. This Pixel C runs Android OS. It does have the detachable, removable monitor piece, tablet, whatever you want to call it. And then it has the keyboard that it can connect to. Mm-hmm. This actually, I've been hearing that this device is a little on the heavy side. Mm-hmm. You're going to be looking at almost 2 pounds. It's not the 5 pounds that you're used to carrying.
Katie,
that's going to feel comfortable.
Huh? Yeah, 2 pounds is still a little hefty when you think about tablets and keyboards.
Katie, just cover this thing with Hello Kitty stickers and you'll be right at home.
Perfect.
Good.
Look at that thing.
Perfect. Can't handle change.
Mm-mm. No.
And this device was built on Marshmallow spec, so it's Android 6 out of the box, and it's leveraging all the bells and whistles,
right? Because this is this is almost like the Nexus, like where this is what we think this should look like in the finest method possible, right? The finest build, the finest, you know, everything in there, right? Specs, software, everything.
I think the device falls a little bit short when it gets, when you get into non-Google apps, mm-hmm. because they're Android developers, and I'm not talking about Google. Android developers really haven't thought through the tablet form factor as much as they have the handset form factor. So it does fall a little bit short when it comes to those. When you're used to iPad apps that look really clean and crisp and designed for the iPad form factor, mm-hmm. I don't think you get the same concept as well as, at least the device is in a 4:3 form factor. So it's kind of like holding that sheet of paper, whereas some of the Surface devices go back to that 16:9 form factor. To me, that's a little bit off.
It'll be interesting to see what everybody thinks of that one and how that goes. To see if that influences also the lower end laptop or not laptops, but conversion tablet, whatever's. So somebody told me Snapchat was down because of Google today.
So Snapchat was down, they're saying, for almost 24 hours.
Oh, wow.
And it was actually tied to an issue on the Google App Engine that I guess Snapchat leverages. I found this story interesting because I was surprised to hear that Snapchat was using some of the Google platform. But then I was thinking about it, and you know, it's probably just like any other platform that uses Amazon's web services and Amazon's virtual environment.
Yeah.
So it's probably not that different. But I did find it interesting that Snapchat being down for so long, first of all, and then that the outage was actually tied to something that was going on at Google.
Wow. Interesting. Well, yeah, everybody's riding on somebody else's. I mean, how many things are started on Amazon cloud services these days, you know, mm-hmm. and you're really dependent on that. So speaking of kind of services real quick, the best way to check your internet speed is dropping flash speedtest.net. Anytime I'm sitting down and I want to know, can I stream this thing? Can I Skype this thing? What I sit down in a coffee shop. I'm like, okay, what extent can I do here? When it comes to my work, because I deal with a lot of large files, apparently it is finally dropping flash. This has been a problem for me because I don't install flash anymore. And if I don't have access easily to Chrome, or Chrome is busy or crashing or whatever, then I don't have speed test and it sucks. But that's good to see. This is part of the continuing thing. I can't remember if we talked about it on the show, but Adobe Flash actually dropping the flash out of its name and becoming, I forgot what the official name, but more focused on the animation side of it as output for HTML5. I think it's a good move for that.
But I definitely agree. And I think that's actually what, isn't it Adobe Animation?
I think it is. Yeah. Because it's used in a lot of stuff you see on television. And again, you know, kind of more focusing tools for HTML5. Real quick, Chilla, for those of us that are not out there into open source, Microsoft is doing a switch and open sourcing part of the Internet Explorer package, right?
Yeah, it's I think some of the engine that comes off of the Edge browser.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to open source that. It sounded like this week was a big bunch of conversations around open source. I think Microsoft open sourced part of the their scripting engine that's part of Edge. Apple open sourced Swift and El Capitan right at the same time as Dropbox and Facebook killed some of their services.
Mm-hmm.
But it's nice to see a lot of the companies going open source, even if it is just portions
mm-hmm.
Of their code. Hopefully this will get other people involved and will just benefit everybody.
Awesome.
Oh, and I just read too that, who was it? Firefox, Mozilla scrapped their mobile OS for low end devices.
Yeah, I heard about that too. There's a lot of death stuff. Mailbox from Dropbox is going away. Also, Carousel for photos. Anytime I hear a story like that and it's a service that I didn't get into, I like, yes, made the right choice. something like that, you know. It's like, oh, why would I get into good, you know? And I'm very careful about that.
Facebook dropped Slingshot, Rooms, and Riff at the same time that Dropbox dropped
Don't
Carousel.
Remember or recall what any of those are? So
Slingshot was like the photo Snapchat type app.
Okay.
Rooms was, I think, some kind of collaboration thing, and I don't know, remember what Riff was.
Wow. Stuff dropping off all around. Hey, so I found some local news for a little bit. First of all, if you haven't had a chance yet, a friend of the show, Josh Lucas from up there in Workhard, Pittsburgh, was featured in Next Pittsburgh. If you guys aren't reading Next Pittsburgh in the area, you really need to. A lot of what's up and coming, not just like technology kind of stuff, but also a bit of, you know, kind of more social, what's going on in town in general.
Sorg, if I may, the new-ish news editor at Next Pittsburgh is a former colleague of mine, Kim Lyons. She does an excellent job. And I think it's noticeable at Next Pittsburgh already. So do check it out. It's a nice site.
I have noticed. Now, I've been following for a bit, and it does seem like all the stuff catching my attention more and more has her name attached to it. So I think that's really, really cool. But they have a really good...
And she would be behind the scenes well, so kind of directing stuff. So I see her fingerprints all over this.
Yes. If you're not familiar, they say, right, the byline art at the top is taking Pittsburgh to the next level. So I say, they're pretty cool look at kind of a day in the life for him and all the stuff he does around there. And it's pretty cool. And a lot of the philosophy that's going on up there, because it's not just like kind of a co-working space where I park my butt on an exercise ball a couple of days a week. But they're doing podcasting, doing a lot of social work, and a lot of the conversation about Allentown, even the drinking partners that had Bill Peduto on episode 50, which is a podcast from Epicast who works out of Workhard as well. Big part of stuff happening up over there. You know, talking about what is happening in Allentown, and they're a big part of that, and that redevelopment, and they're trying to make sure they don't repeat the mistakes happening in East Liberty with all the stuff coming up there. And I gotta say, just in the past year, it looked that place, you know, I was always iffy about going up there and doing work on a regular basis, but the neighborhood's coming up a bit, and it feels pretty good. So go check that out, nextpittsburgh.com. And also a shout to, hey, did you know there's a new tech talk show on PCTV? If you guys have the local cable, but it's also on YouTube as well. But it's Pittsburgh Tech Talk, and go give it a shot. They're talking about some businesses in the area as well. Look up PCTV21 on YouTube. I believe it's PCTV21.org. We talked with a few members over there, including on Awesome Chat in recent months as well, and talking about how they're more than just cable access. They're actually making this as kind of a funnel to make cool, better stuff for YouTube for community producers. You know, so again, we talk about all that stuff you can do on your phone, but these guys are giving you kind of access to better higher end stuff and learning how to do video editing and having access to other, you know, means and methods and equipment. So go check that out on PCTV. And from there, I think that's all my shout outy stuff. And also please check out Awesome Chat this past week. We talked with Leo over at 412 Food Rescue, and we're going to be talking this week with the guy behind See Me, playseeme.com, CEEMI, a very interesting music concept. Where you don't have to exactly know how to play music to be involved in a very group kind of activity sort of thing. And we had a lot of fun with that as well. So anything going around the area you guys want to plug? Uncle Crappy, he's at the Post Gazette. Post-Gazette.com.
Post-Gazette.com. And actually, if you go back and look at the Beer Me site, post-gazette.com/beer me, on Thursday evening, we will have this week's show posted. It is sort of a gift guide, some gift suggestions, beer, craft beer related. So if you've got a person like that on your gift list, you want to take a look at that one.
Go check it out. John Chachilla, at Chilla on the Twitters.
I'm actually checking to see if post-hypen gazette.com is open to buy bot, and it is.
Oh,
if you're looking to buy post-hyphen gazette.com, it is available. Wow.
I think you better send somebody an email before they hear this episode.
that's well outside of my responsibility. I'm not even going to get into it.
Somebody tell him on Twitter. And I was like, hey, Dudders on the Twitter, can he do this? getting stuck in elevators or whatever mobile devices.
Using old tech and getting stuck in elevators. That's what right. You need to know about me.
That's probably why you broke the elevator, because you were it was overweight because of the 5-pound laptop on this.
You wait, one day I'm going to take down somebody and I'm not going to have a 5-pound laptop. I'm going to have like 2-pounder and I'm going to be like... Oh.
Primary self-defense device.
Mace, have a laptop.
There's an old Penny Arcade comic where somebody just like takes out his buddy with an original Xbox because it's so large. Like that's like I can just place you in that laptop in there. Can't,
right yes.
There. Wow. Anything going on with you? You want to plug?
No, I'm just, nothing I feel very interesting. Boring at the moment. Nothing, I'll find something else to do.
You had everything last week, of course. Sorgatron.com. We got, again, if you want to check out about me talking about more extensively about Wirecast and Black Magic, and check out the Wednesday episode this week. I talk about something that I don't usually touch on the internet.
Ooh.
And we'll leave you at that. And of course, everything else is SorgatronMedia.com, not just tech, but we also have pro wrestling, video games, and so much more from our client podcast as well. And thank you, everybody, live.sorgatronmedia.com. I'm thinking ahead to the other shows tonight. Live.sorgatronmedia.com about 6:30 p.m. Eastern time. We start rolling in, getting started. You can join us in the chat room, AwesomeCast, on the Twitters and the Facebooks, and AwesomeCast.net for all the shows. Subscribe, check out our Patreon, and so much more. And at least, at the very least, please share the show. Like, comment. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you to our awesome chat room, including Kraus, Wheels, and Juggalo John, and so much more. You've been our awesome audience. Awesome. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.